Belinda and ABC Audio present this unabridged recording of Rowan of the Bukshah, Rowan of Rin number 5. Written by Emily Rodda and read by Rachael Blake.
Chapter 1. It is a curse. The village of Rin huddled, freezing, in a silent world of white. Deep snow blanketed the valley. The mountain brooded against the grey sky, like a vast ice sculpture capped with cloud. Never had there been a winter like this. Never had the snow fallen so thickly. Never had the cold been so bitter. And never had it lasted so long. By the calendar, it was spring, the time for planting, and for blossom, bees, and nesting birds. But still the air was deadly chill. Fields and gardens lay buried, and snow weighed down the bare branches of the trees in Strong John's orchard. A meeting was called, but it was too cold for the people to gather in the village square. They crowded instead in the House of Books, shivering and murmuring amid the smell of oil lamps, parchment, and old paper. Deep shadows flickered on worried faces, gesturing hands. The lamps were turned low, for oil, like everything else, was in short supply. Rowan, who had been in the Bukshah field when the meeting bell sounded, arrived last of all. For a time he stood outside the door, stamping the snow from his boots. Despite the cold, he was in no hurry to enter. He knew what old Lan, the village leader, was going to say to the people, and he had made his own decision on what he was going to do about it. For now, his mind was still with the Bukshah. The great gentle beasts he tended had strayed again during the night. They tried it every winter, but this year they had broken out of their field over and over again. This time, they had wandered past the silent mill, its huge wheels stuck fast in the ice of the stream, and moved on till they had almost reached the base of the mountain. It had taken hours to tempt them back to their field, hours, and the last few handfuls of oats from the storehouse. "There will be trouble when it is discovered those oats are gone," Rowan thought ruefully. "But what else could I do? Let the Bukshah wander off to die?" He did not blame the beasts for breaking down their fence. They were hungry. The bales of hay on which they fed in winter were almost gone. And in a desperate attempt to make the food last, Rowan had been forced to cut their daily ration by half. Several of the oldest and frailest members of the herd had already weakened and died. But Rowan knew that if food was scarce in the valley, it did not exist at all outside it. Except where sheer rocky cliffs showed as brutal gashes on the shimmering whiteness of the mountain, the land was snow-covered on every side, as far as the eye could see. "You must stop trying to stray, Star," Rowan had said to his favourite, the leader of the herd, when at last all the beasts were back in their field. "You must stay here, where I can care for you." Star had turned her great head to look at him and rumbled deep in her throat. Her small dark eyes were troubled. She wanted to please Rowan and obey him, but all her instincts were telling her that he was wrong. Dimly understanding, Rowan had patted her, feeling with dismay the jutting ribs beneath her shaggy coat. "Spring will surely come soon, Star," he had whispered. "The snow will melt, and there will be grass for you to eat once more. Just a little longer." But how much longer? Rowan thought now. How long can this go on? Gritting his teeth, he pushed open the door and slipped into the crowded room. Sharon and Norris, the two young people he had rescued from the enemy land of the Zebak, moved quickly to his side. They had clearly been watching for him. Sharon's soft eyes were anxious, but her brother's face was alive with curiosity. "Where have you been hiding yourself, Rowan?" Norris whispered. "We have not seen you for days." He grinned and glanced at his sister teasingly. Sharon thinks you've been avoiding us. She fears we've done something to offend you. Please put her out of her misery and tell her it is not so.
Norris?
Sharon hissed, blushing scarlet. Rowan forced a smile. Of course you have not offended me, he murmured. That at least he could say truly, though he could not deny the rest. How could he have been with his friends and not told him what was going to happen? So he had avoided them. But now they were about to hear everything. His heart ached at the thought of their dismay. Norris would have pressed him further, but at that moment there was movement at the front of the room. Lan, the village leader, was preparing to speak. She was standing in the place of honour, in front of the hanging strips of painted silk, which told in pictures the ancient story of the Rin people's slavery in the land of the Zebak. The bright paintings, glimmering in the lamplight, made a strange background to her sober figure. For over 300 years, the Rin people had lived in freedom in their green valley, with no memory of their past, and no idea that many of their own had been left behind in the dreaded place across the sea. Then, just over a year ago, Rowan's little sister Anad had been snatched away and carried to the land of the Zebak. Determined to save her, Rowan had followed. He had found her, against all odds. And at the same time, he had found Sharon and Norris, the last of the lost ones. Sharon had brought the box of silks with her when they escaped. And ever since that time, the silks had hung in the House of Books, to be marvelled over and discussed endlessly by the people of the village. Lan called for silence. Everyone turned to face her, and a tense hush fell.
Friends, Lan said, I ask you to listen carefully to what I have to say.
She spoke firmly, taking charge as she had done so often before. But it seemed to Rowan that her face had grown more haggard overnight, and that she leaned more heavily on her stick. Rowan's stepfather, John of the Orchard, stood at her right hand, and Timon, the teacher, at her left. She looked very frail between them.
Our situation is grave, Lan said. The storehouse is almost empty, and the snow shows no sign of melting. Why this should be so?
It is a curse, cried a voice from the centre of the room. People turned, craning their necks to see who had spoken. It was Neil the Potter. His narrow face was pale and pinched. A curse, he repeated shrilly. We have offended the mountain, and now the mountain has turned against us. Rowan felt a chill that had nothing to do with his soaked boots or frozen fingers. That is foolish talk, Neil, said John quietly. It is not, cried Neil. There has never been a winter such as this one. It is unnatural. Ask Timon if you do not believe me. Timon has examined the weather records. He knows I speak the truth. All eyes now turned to Timon, who smoothed his grey beard nervously. This winter is certainly harsher than any we have had before, he said in his quiet, hesitating voice. But there is no need to talk of curses. Our winters have been growing harder and longer for many years, and we must remember that we have lived in this valley for only 3 centuries. In a land as ancient as this, 300 years are but the blink of an eye. Who can say what is natural and what is not? There is a traveller's tale that tells of... Lan nudged him, and he broke off. But it was too late. Neil was already nodding violently, his reddened eyes gleaming in the lamplight. Exactly, Neil cried. The tale of the cold time, when winter held the land in a thrall, and ice creepers came down from the mountain seeking warm flesh to devour. A chorus of jeers, led by Brondon the furniture maker, echoed around the room.
Oh, I remember that one, called Alan the baker. My grandmother told it by the fire one winter's night when I was 6 years old. As I recall, I took my wooden sword to bed with me, and lay awake for hours waiting for the ice creepers to attack. There was a ripple of laughter. Neil bared his teeth. "You mock me, and ignore the message of the tale at your peril," he shouted. "Alan the baker is half-traveller himself, and should know better. Is he not always telling us that travellers have roamed this land for almost as long as the Bukshah have grazed below the mountain? And that travellers' tales seem fanciful, but most are woven around a grain of truth?" The laughter faltered and died. "Neil is right," quavered Solla the sweetmaker, his soft chins wobbling as he spoke. "Remember the Valley of Gold? We thought it was just a traveller's legend. Then its ruins were found on the other side of the mountain. It was real enough once, and so were the people who lived in it, though they are long dead and gone." The villagers murmured uncomfortably. The noise grew louder, quieting only when Lan held up her hand. "The traveller's cold-time tale simply proves my point," said Timon firmly. "It proves that there is nothing unnatural about this cold. There has clearly been at least one long, terrible winter in the land before this, a season hard enough to have passed into legend. Now..."
"You are deliberately ignoring the most important thing, Timon," Neil broke in shrilly. "In the tale, the cold time came because the people of the Valley of Gold turned their backs on the mountain and failed to honour it. And we have done the same."
He stabbed a trembling finger at the lengths of painted silk hanging behind Lan.
"These images of another land and a time long gone have no place in our valley. They offend the mountain. They must be burned."
Rowan's stomach lurched. The room rang with shouts of shock and protest. Norris was red-faced, his fists clenched. Even Sharon had forgotten her shyness and was crying out. Norris and Sharon had spent their lives guarding the silks in the land of the Zebak. The thought of the precious old paintings being destroyed was horrifying to them both.
"The silks are our history, Neil," said Lan, her gnarled hands tightening on her stick.
"No," exclaimed Neil angrily. "Rin's story, the only story that matters, began the day our ancestors rose against their Zebak masters on this land shore and began a new life."
He whirled around, appealing to his neighbours.
"Our ancestors were brought to this land to help the Zebak conquer it. But instead, the land gave them their freedom, and this valley became their home," he cried. "Once, that history was all we knew, and it was enough for us."
He turned and stared at Norris and Sharon, his face sharp with dislike.
"But ever since the silks and their guardians were brought here, all this has changed. Suddenly, our minds are filled with questions about times long past and best forgotten. How long did our ancestors live as slaves in the land of the Zebak? Where did they come from at first? Is there another land, an even better land than this, which was once our own and perhaps could be so again?"
"It is natural for us to wonder, Neil," said John. "There is no harm in it."
"There is harm!"
Neil gestured wildly, his voice rising to a shriek.
"Do you not see? By looking back, by questioning, we have rejected the mountain's gift of life. And now the mountain is offended and is taking its revenge."
John made a disgusted sound, and Timon shook his head.
"Never have I heard such foolishness," snapped Lan,
her faded eyes flashing with some of their old fire.
"Be quiet, Neil. Let others with stronger heads than yours go on with the business for which this meeting was intended."
Neil flushed, and without another word, pushed his way through the crowd and out of the room, slamming the door behind him. But Rowan could see that not everyone in the room agreed with Lan. Several people were glancing sympathetically after Neil, and Solla the sweetmaker, for one, looked very nervous. Perhaps Lan could see this too, and was angered, for when she spoke again, her voice was even harsher than it had been before.
"As I was saying, our situation is grave," she rasped. "By my calculation..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books,
Use the link in the video description.